this morning. Before we dive into the study for this morning, it's a pretty momentous occasion for a couple of families today. It's good to see Riker, the camp here with David and Cheryl. Be sure that you meet Riker this morning if you've not met him yet. We're thankful to see him this morning. I believe that's his first time with us, and we're so grateful for that. It's also first Sunday for LaBlaine Harding back here on the back pew. And Sage and Ashlyn are here with him today, bringing him. LaBlaine didn't drive, so we're thankful that he's here on his first Sunday with us as well. Be sure that you show them the love of the Lord today. And sitting next to Brooke and Dakota, the Lord willing, will have little Emmy here with us the next couple of weeks or months. And she'll be here soon in the next few days. Let's pause and let's pray for both of these good families, and we're so glad to see their little ones here today. Father God, we're thankful for you giving us all the blessings of life, and we continue to be so humbled by life itself, giving of life itself. And we're so excited and rejoice when we see new life. And we're thankful to see Riker here this morning. We're thankful for David and Cheryl. Continue to bless that family. We're thankful to see Blaine. We pray that you'll bless Sage and Ashley. We thank you so much for being able to be assembled here together with them this morning. We pray for both of these families that you'll help them as they train and lead and guide these young men. Help them to lead them in a way that follows after you. Help us as a church to do all we can to come alongside them, to help and strengthen and equip them as they raise them as well. We thank you for the precious privilege it is to have young children, to have babies. Help us to be the best stewards of them that we can be in all things. We're thankful for Jesus who gives us hope and gives these little ones hope. It's in his name that we pray. Amen.
It's even more fitting as we think about the song that we'll sing in just a moment.
Do remember, Tuesday night, Matt will bring a great lesson, I know, from the Book of Esther. As we study through our familiar faces, be sure that you're here, be sure that you stay afterward. We had our best crowd of the summer this past Tuesday night, and we look forward to seeing you again this coming Tuesday. So be sure that you're here to hear Matt go through Esther. Let's sing verse 2 of Because He Lives. So recognizing these babies this morning and singing this song is especially fitting for us to do together. Verse 2 of Because He Lives.
How sweet to hold a newborn baby and feel the pride and joy he gives. But greater still, the calm assurance this child can face uncertain days because he
feels that way sometimes. But still is that calm, anchoring assurance that God has given us in Christ. No matter the size of the uncertain days, calm assurance, full assurance that God has given us in Christ will anchor us, help us to continue to grow. We're winding down this study of blessed assurance from this paragraph of the book of Colossians. It begins in chapter 1 and verse 21, as Paul has just finished elevating Christ, or at least shining a spotlight on how elevated Christ is, that we should aspire to elevating Christ in our lives, in our homes, and all we do, to the degree that he is elevated and exalted by God. He holds everything together. Thus, to follow him means he holds everything together in our lives. Paul then shifts, and he talks about how he is qualified to write to them, not just merely saying I'm an apostle. He He says, I've been given this mission from God, and to show you that I am a servant of God, I suffer. And I suffer with Christ and like Christ. And so you can know that what I'm writing to you about Christ is true because of the price and the struggle that I'm willing to pay. Then last week we mentioned that his emphasis through chapter 2 and verse 7 on their assurance is in one way pointed toward their stability. He wants them to know God gives assurance in Christ because they need to be stable in times that are often unstable. Voices that would like to rob them of stability. He says your stability is found in Christ. This morning as we close this section up, we add to that that he also addresses this assurance because he's concerned about their satisfaction. He gives them stability in Christ, but he also gives them, as Christians, full satisfaction in Christ. And here's how he does this. It's through the key word riches. Twice he mentions the riches of Christ, and then a third time he mentions the treasures that are found in Christ. So when God saves us in Christ, he makes us rich in Christ. And that should satisfy us. Let's notice chapter 1 and verse 25. I'm going to put 27 on the screen, but let's look at verse 25 to lead into this. Of which I became a minister, according to the stewardship from God that was given to me for you, to make the word of God fully known. The mystery hidden for ages and generations, but now revealed to his saints. To them God chose to make known how great among the Gentiles are, notice, the riches of the glory of this mystery, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory. So here Paul is casting a wide net. This is God. Message to proclaim the mystery which we have talked about, that Christ is the mystery and it's the gospel that all man, Jew and Gentile alike can be saved in him. Paul's saying it's his desire. He has this account, as it were, of his glory to make that known to all mankind. Well, what does that mean? What does it look like? What does glory, the riches of glory, look like? Now what's interesting is you take that word riches and you narrow it down to all the times that it's used metaphorically, used spiritually, not riches of this world, but just spiritual riches in Christ. Four of those are riches of glory. Riches and glory are often paired together in the New Testament. What's glory? Glory is the manifestation of the qualities of God. God is bigger than we can imagine. He's bigger than we know. But when we get a glimpse of him, when we understand who he is, that is his glory. So a day like today, we might go outside and it's cloudy and it's kind of overcast. We don't need sunglasses. We don't need a hat to shield our eyes. The sun is still burning as hot as ever. It's still producing the same amount of energy. But we don't see it. We just see its effects. Some days we walk outside and it's blinding, we say. We have to squint. We need the sunglasses. We need a hat to shield our eyes. That's kind of what glory is describing. The key word, the root word for the word glory in the Greek is actually the same root for thinking or recognizing. So God is all of these wonderful, immutable attributes, and when we understand them, when we see them in action, that's beholding his glory. Paul's saying he's made known the riches of his glory. Acts chapter 22, verse 11, where Paul describes his journey to Damascus and that interruption by the Lord. You remember he says, I could not see because of the brightness of the light. Literally, the glory of the light I could not see. It's the manifestation of him seeing the Lord. You get to Revelation chapter 21, and it's verse 11 there, that the holy city, the heavenly city itself, radiates with the glory of God. Verse 23, there's no sun or moon in the city. Why? Because the glory of God is the city's light. So Paul's saying it's God's desire for all mankind to be able to behold God through the life, the message of Jesus Christ. that when we obey and we behold Christ, we're beholding the glory of God. It's his desire to make himself known in those terms. So we say riches of glory, overwhelming abundance or wealth of glory. And I can't help but think of Aladdin. The Cave of Wonder, whether it's the legend of Aladdin or the two movies that Disney has produced, Aladdin has to go into the cave to find the lamp. And when he does, there's countless coins and jewels and treasure chests. If you and I took a laptop and a spreadsheet and tried to get an inventory list of all of that, we'd come up short. We could not do it. And then we take another level beyond that. Let's say we could get an itemized list and we tried to figure out its value, we would still come up way short. We couldn't figure out the value of all these unsearchable riches. God wants us to know that when he makes himself available and known through his Son to all of mankind, it's far too great for us to count. It's far too great for us to be able to come to a number, be able to create a list. He makes available himself in giving us his glory. Listen to how Peter would talk about this in 2 Peter chapter 1. His divine power has granted to us all things that pertain to life and godliness through the knowledge of him who called us to his own glory and excellence. You see that? He's made everything known to us that we need to live in this life. Brings us closer to his glory and excellence. And continues, by which he has granted to us his precious and very great promises. He brings us up to this level of his glory, his own excellence, by giving us knowledge and wisdom. He wants us to know, I've given you everything that you need. Solomon would talk about this in Proverbs chapter 2 when he talks about wisdom. Solomon in just a minute. God's desire is our access. He makes widely known his riches to all mankind. But directly, he gives them to us. He gives them to you. He gives them to me. And that's what Paul's point eventually is here in chapter 2. Chapter 1, he says, here's my mission, here's my message, it's for all. But now he zeroes in chapter 2 to say, this is why I'm writing to you. Verse 1, it's to you, it's to the Laodiceans, those around you. And you remember at the end of this book, he's going to say, you be sure your letter is read there and their letter is read to you, and you pass these letters around. But then he says, verse 2, here's why I'm writing. I want you to know how great a struggle I have. Verse 2, that their hearts may be encouraged, being knit together in love, to reach all the riches of full assurance, of understanding and the knowledge of God's mystery, which is Christ. There it is, specific. The wide net, here's what God desires for all. And now I want you to know how personal this is. He wants you to mine and to know the full assurance, God's understanding. And how does he portray that? All the riches of full assurance. Now in chapter 1 and verse 9, he's talked about his prayer for them is to have full knowledge, be filled with all knowledge and wisdom. Now he's following back up on that theme. Not just full knowledge, but understanding in that knowledge. And he's pointing to show that it's through assurance that that knowledge keeps working to secure us and to satisfy us in Christ. Now listen to verse 3 where he goes, in whom are hidden all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge. So you see the trajectory he's already set forth. Now here's why I'm writing to you, to remind you that God has made available to you all the riches of full assurance, understanding and knowledge, and all the treasures of wisdom are found in Christ. The word to reach that the ESV does with the word reach there is actually just a preposition. It doesn't literally mean reach. It's just the word for or into. We talk about Acts 2:38, when we talk about the preposition ace, that's what it is. It's for So you see, there's just a movement spatially that Paul is envisioning for them for the purpose of deepening all the more in these riches of full assurance through Christ. That should spark within us these questions. How deep can I go in the wisdom and the riches found in Christ? What all can I discover in what is there in Christ? So it's here that we turn our attention to Solomon. Proverbs chapter 2. When Solomon would talk about wisdom, and he's trying to compel his son and other young men to listen to him, to avoid some of the same mistakes that he has made, and to talk about the value of wisdom, he says, chapter 2 of Proverbs in verse 4, if you seek it, wisdom, like silver, if you search for it as hidden treasures, then you will understand the fear of the Lord and find the knowledge of God. You hear it? If you will have the same drive and the same motivation, the same urgency that you would have to earn an extra dollar or two, to save an extra discount, to find a couple of more percentage points of interest, if you will seek the wisdom of God with the same urgency you would physical treasures, then you will understand the fear of the Lord. Then you'll find the knowledge of God. For the Lord gives wisdom. From his mouth come knowledge and understanding. Listen to verse 7. He stores up wisdom for the upright. You hear the imagery he's painting now. He's storing up wisdom for the upright. Well, how do we find it? We seek it. We seek it with all that we have. And the more we seek it, the more we find, we keep finding it from God. And what Paul has done is he's saying that not only generally has Paul, as God, made his wisdom available, but now he's made it directly available in Christ. And he's made it directly available to you, you Christians in Colossae, and now 2,000 years removed, you Christians in Paris. Jesus himself connects some of these dots to compel us to see how important this is. That's what he was teaching in the scripture reading this morning from Luke chapter 8. Remind ourselves again of that text, Luke chapter 8, verse 16. Speaking of himself, the gospel, the new message, the new covenant. No one, after lighting a lamp, covers it with a jar or puts it under a bed, but puts it on a stand so that those who enter may see the light. See, Jesus is the lamp, the light of God that's revealing the glory of God to the world. Verse 17, for nothing is hidden that will not be made manifest, nor is anything secret that will not be known and come to light. You hear how closely related to the mystery language of Colossians 1 and 2 that is? Jesus says, now that I am here, now that I have come, everything that God determined to reveal to man has set back for man. He now is revealing in Christ. So why does that matter, Jesus? Well, listen to verse 18. Take care, then, how you hear. When you understand how valuable it is, will you then take care to how you hear? For to the one who has, more will be given. The more, what's all that said? The more you seek, the more you will find it. And from the one who has not, even what he thinks he has, will be taken away. If we take Jesus' point there from verse 18, we try to ask a strong question about ourselves. What would change about our Bible study habits, about our spiritual growth habits, about applying what we learn from Scripture, about coming to an understanding about Scripture? What would happen to those things if somehow God promised to give us money in our bank accounts every time we study? Every time we open the text, deposit. Every time we memorize Scripture, deposit. Every time we talk of Scripture, deposit. Every time we have a breakthrough in our minds where we've learned and studied these principles, and now we see them in light of other Scriptures, now there's a breakthrough and it makes sense, deposit. Or about something we've known for years, we've struggled to implement, and then we begin to apply it in our spiritual lives, deposit. Would that change the urgency about which we view the knowledge of God and of His Son? Which is more valuable, our bank accounts or our souls? also gives you satisfaction. As we move into the latter part of this section, we find this practical instruction, these imperatives. I want to just notice quickly the thread of how this riches concept, satisfaction, connects to these commands. So when we activate our assurance, we activate these riches, we see it gives us satisfaction. And here's why it matters. A fully satisfied person cannot be enticed. A fully satisfied person cannot be enticed. First thing he mentions, chapter 2 and verse 4. I say this, on the immediately following full assurance, all the riches of full assurance, chapter 2, verse 2, all the treasures hidden in Christ, verse 3, then verse 4. I say this in order that no one may delude you, entice you with plausible arguments. In a few weeks, once August gets here, we might have some dry land. You go out there and you run the hose pipe, and it's going to soak it up immediately because it's so dry. Take a day like today or a rainy couple of weeks, or you go back to the spring and you run the hose pipe and it just pools up or it begins to roll downhill because the ground is saturated. If you want to fully inject the ground with something, herbicide or pesticide or fertilizer or something, to take oversaturated ground and try to inject it then, it's more futile. It's less effective. But when it's parched, it drinks up every drop of water that you expose it to. If you poison that water, or you strengthen that water with something, you soak it up just as well. So here's the picture Paul's painting. You've got all the riches of God in Christ. You've got all the treasures of God in Christ. So now I'm saying, people will come around you and they will try to tempt you and entice you and lure you away by arguments that sound plausible. And if your soul is parched, your soul is dry, you're vulnerable. If your heart is set on the riches of God in Christ, and your heart is full of the treasures of God that are found in Christ, and you won't be swayed away. Whether that's doctrinal false teachings we think about, like regarding salvation, or worship, the church, or whether that's moral teachings, those come by way of seducements and enticements. The messaging is out there. Just give in to these moral degradations because it's how we're designed. Maybe it's things that would cause us to be irresponsible. Maybe it's things that are emotionally charged instead of fact-based and truth-based. The less satisfied we are in Christ, the more vulnerable we are to things that will destroy our souls. Then he says, chapter 2 and verse 6, as you receive Christ, so walk in him. He's pointing them toward how they live in everything. And chapter 3 really emphasizes that difference. Here's how the new life looks. So think about how in all of these areas in chapter 3, a fully satisfied life lives. What attraction? The things like anger, wrath, malice, slander, and obscenity. What do they carry for us when we are full of the peace of Christ within? What value is dishonesty when we're full of the truth of Christ? What's the allure of divisions and discrimination when we are seeking the unity that's in Christ? What's our fascination with resentment? And we should be full of the forgiveness that comes from Christ. Why would we pursue selfishness instead of the perfect love of Christ? How would our marriages look if each spouse was fully and daily satisfied with Christ and then sought to serve the other with all their being? How would our parenting change if we as parents decided once and for all to be fulfilled and satisfied ourselves by the discipline and instruction of the Lord? How would our work ethic in all of our areas of life change if we drew our strength from pleasing Christ instead of from seeking to please man? Assurance, full riches, all the riches of full assurance. We draw all of our strength from him in those things. we're satisfied, how do you see it? You see it at the end of verse 7, chapter 2. We're walking in him, verse 6, we're rooted, built up in him, established in the faith, just as you were taught, abounding in thanksgiving. You'll notice the specific term. He doesn't just say with thanksgiving or be thankful. That would have been enough. That would have been good. But he says abounding in thanksgiving. Overflowing with thanksgiving. When's the last time we saw something overflow? You had a waitress recently to overfill your glass with water, or maybe the ice falls out unexpectedly and causes that displacement and it spills over the edge. Overflowing. Now, when's the last time we could say we overflowed with thanksgiving? We're abounded with thanksgiving. If you're like me, it's easy to say, well, I overflowed with this quality or this attitude, and it's far from noble. It's far from thanksgiving. When's the last time we could say we abound in gratitude and thanksgiving to God? It's the natural response for understanding the treasures God sets aside for us to enjoy in Christ should be thanksgiving. It is thanksgiving. And so we go back to that cave, and it's full of these treasures. They're hidden in Christ, and we keep finding them. And we pick one up, and we hold it up. Look at this treasure. And then we say, how great is the one who gives it to us? Overflow with thanksgiving. It keeps pouring out of us. Now, chapter 3, verse 16, has Paul talking about this. Let the word of Christ dwell in you, and dwell in you how? Dwell in you richly. Teaching, admonishing one another, singing one another songs, hymns, spiritual songs. With thankfulness in your hearts to God. How does it come out? It comes out ultimately in gratitude, thanksgiving. So this morning, what we've already done in singing and in worshiping together is participating in abounding in thanksgiving. It is a tremendous blessing that we've been able to do that and we get to do that. Do we have the same urgency, the same commitment to know that it's just as important of a blessing to live Monday through Saturday pouring out thanksgiving because we keep pouring into our hearts and saturating them with Christ and his innumerable treasures that God has put away for us to enjoy in him. This morning, this assurance, these treasures in Christ are not yours. Would you let that change today by putting them on a baptism? We'd love to study with you if you have questions about that. We'd love to see you.